Very well.
Good morning, good afternoon, or even good evening for some of you. A very warm welcome to our second public webinar, this time on the documentary standards of the USP-NF and how to navigate them online. I'm Alex Fichter, part of a great team of USP colleagues operating from the USP office in Basel, Switzerland. We are representing USP in Europe, Middle East, and Africa. As one of four strategic customer development managers, as Benoit mentioned in this team, I oversee Central and Eastern Europe and engage with our end users on different USP topics. Well, considering the difficulties to travel nowadays and not being able to meet with our customers face to face, we decided to innovate our outreach and instead conduct several webinars to at least meet with you virtually. We have lined up several webinars for you with different and recurring topics like this one on the USP online. The next one will be on what you always wanted to know about USP reference standards, which will be scheduled for July 22nd. Future webinar topics will be on impurities, performance verification testing, so-called PVT, excipients, and USP standards on biologics, just to name a few. So let's begin with today's webinar on documentary standards of the USP-NF and how to navigate them online. But before talking or taking you to the topic of standard setting, let me go back in history and introduce USP to you with its long tradition of helping establish the quality and safety of medicines, dietary supplements, and foods. It all started with a desperate need for medicine quality before USP was founded. The practice of medicines in the US was very chaotic. There were no uniform standards for quality. Medicines could often be far more dangerous than the cures they were supposed to provide. In 1820, 11 physicians took action to protect patients from poor quality medicines. They founded the first Pharmacopeia of the United States. By the way, the painting to the right is of the old Senate chamber at the US Capitol, where they met on January 1st, 1820, to establish the US Pharmacopeia Convention. From the beginning, USP had an integral part to public health. USP was first recognized in the Drug Importation Act of 1848, which aimed to stop the uncontrolled flow of pure quality or poor quality and ineffective drugs imported mainly from Europe. Going forward, imported drugs had to meet the standards for strength and purity established in the USP. With the Pure Food and Drug Act from 1906, the FDA was founded as a means to fight adulterated and mislabeled food and medicines. The act also recognized the US Pharmacopeia and the National Formulary, a separate pharmacopeia next to the USP, as official compendia under federal law. In 1938, the Congress responded with the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act to the unfortunate instance where more than 100 people died, poisoned by an antibiotic which had not been tested for toxicity. Companies were now requested to submit the test data to FDA before marketing. And this legislation required companies to test new drugs to verify they meet USP standards for identity, quality, packaging, and labeling next to already strength and purity. These are early examples of FDA and USP's collaboration, and we continue today to work together as it is essential to ensure appropriate quality standards. USP becomes a vital resource when strategy strikes. Several past crises accented the need for quality standards. In collaboration with FDA and other stakeholders, USP responded with the development of new or to be revised public standards. In 1903, USP introduced a public standard for a diphtheria antitoxin to safeguard its manufacture. This was the first ever biologic product monograph admitted into the US Pharmacopeia. Between 1992 and 2007, mass poisoning occurred in Panama, China, Haiti, Bangladesh, Argentina, Nigeria, and India because of a toxic diethylene glycol that was used instead of the more expensive non-toxic glycerin in cough syrups and other medicines. At the request of FDA, USP further revised the monograph for glycerin. At the same time, FDA issued guidance on the testing of glycerin for diethylene glycol. In 2007, a heparin product deliberately tainted with a toxic substance caused the deaths of nearly 150 people and injured 100 more. The FDA asked USP to change the heparin standard to include testing techniques so that the added substance could be detected. Since then, USP has revised the heparin standard to include other impurities. USP also further refined testing methods for the heparin monographs. I can name more recent ones like the melamine scandal or a meningitis outbreak linked to a compounded medicines, and even the current nitrosamine issue. Our mission to improve global health through public standards and related programs that help ensure the quality, safety, and benefits of medicines and foods got nurtured with the lives we help saving for the past two centuries. Empowering a healthy tomorrow requires a strong foundation. One that establishes quality, sets the bar for scientific rigor and technological progress, and epitomizes collaboration between industry, non-for-profits, government, and academia. So who is USP today? We are a non-profit, private, independent, and self-funded public organization focused on quality standards to protect the public health. We have a global focus and are recognized as Pharmacopeia of choice in 150 countries. Our headquarters in Rockville, near Washington, D.C., is one of our regional bases next to our offices in Hyderabad, Shanghai, Singapore, Basel, and Sao Paulo. Some of them also have laboratory facilities to support our collaborative effort in setting public standards and characterizing reference standards. The separately created and funded Promoting the Quality of Medicines Plus, we call it PQM Plus program, is operating independently from USP out of offices in Ethiopia, Indonesia, and the Philippines, and helps improving the access to quality assured priority medicines in low and middle income countries. More than 1,000 USP employees support the volunteerate of roughly 900 scientists, practitioners, and regulators to develop the public standards. The USP organizational structure is under a convention. The convention is a membership body that is one of USP3's governing bodies. It includes 492 member organizations from across science and healthcare and from around the globe. Member delegates gather every 5 years for important governance decisions, and throughout the five-year cycle, the USP convention works together to advance priority issues that improve public health, patient safety, and access to quality medicines. This year's 2020 convention was originally planned as a three-day in-person meeting in Washington, D.C. with programming, speakers, anniversary events, and governance activities. As the coronavirus grew more widespread, the convention meeting was transitioned to a virtual event focused on governance activities. as you can see from the very below of this chart, the USP stuff is there to support all these bodies, the convention members, the expert committees, to make sure they are discussing on relevant topics and standards. In the 2020 convention, we brought 15 approved resolutions to light, which will drive our organization for the next 5 years and beyond. First and foremost, USP will continue its commitment to collaboration with the US Food and Drug Administration, the FDA, industry and other stakeholders by identifying shared priorities based on scientific principles and leveraging USP's capabilities to help advance patient safety, public health, innovation, and access to quality medicines. I could name all the 15 resolutions that are kind of equally important and ways for us to contribute our efforts in the future, but I think in the interest of time, I will move on. Many of you may ask, what is the relationship with FDA, since we are a private, non-for-profit organization and independent from government? We established compendial standards that are responsible for the development and revision together with an industry collaboration. We set public standards for identity, strength, quality, purity, packaging, and labeling. FDA is enforcing these standards with marketing authorization holders who have approved products to market in the US. Our standards are used by the FDA labs, who are frequently testing samples obtained from local pharmacies. However, as you heard before, FDA's engagement with us and stakeholders goes beyond enforcing our standards. As we estimate our standards to impact around 2 billion people globally, we believe that USP standards play a very important role by expanding access to medicines of good quality. Those standards are developed in collaboration with all stakeholders, government, industry, and scientists. Standards are even more important in the context of global supply chain. Standards are also used to combat counterfeit drugs. USP plays a critical role in the trust a patient may have when taking a medicine. Both patients and practitioners assume that their drugs are safe, efficacious, and have the correct identity, deliver the same performance as described in the label, perform consistently over their shelf life, are made in a manner that ensures quality, and last but not least, will be available when needed. Adulteration is a legal term, meaning that product fails to meet the legal standards. In the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act of 1938, one can read that a drug product in the US market must conform to the standards in USP-NF to avoid possible charges of adulteration and misbranding. The supply chain of the component of a medicine became extremely complex during last decades. Our standards help detect adulteration, especially during crisis time. A substandard medicine may contain no active ingredients, less than required amount, or too much of the required amount. It may also contain ingredients not described on the packaging label. Quality can deteriorate in many settings, for example, during manufacturing, packaging, distribution, and storage. This is especially true in developing countries where supply chains are long and fragmented. Compliance with USP standards help assure that patients receive quality medicines. A very poor part, falsified medicines. They are intentionally sold to unsuspecting patients for profit. Like substandard medicines, they may contain no active ingredient, less than the required amount of active ingredients, or too much of the active ingredients, or even ingredients not described on the package label. In just 1 year, a projected 122,000 children under the age of 5 from 39 sub-Saharan African countries lost their lives as a result of quantified antimalarial drugs alone. USP works with local regulators around the world to develop the capacity to detect and remove falsified and substandard medicines from the market. And in all fairness to say, indirectly, with the support of USP, with the order of reference standards in our publications, you are indirectly supporting this horrible and intentionally sold to unsuspected patients process by companies who are only in for their profit. According to the review of antimicrobial resistance, roughly 700,000 people die each year due to drug resistance and illness such as bacterial infections, malaria, HIV/AIDS, or tuberculosis. We know that substandard and falsified medicines can contribute to multi-drug resistant strains. Quality standards of pharmacopeias around the world help ensure the identity, strength, quality, and purity of medicines. They provide a measure to which to test, and thus they reduce AMR by helping keep subpotent medicines out of the market. This objective can be further advanced by enhancing the capacity of regulatory authorities and manufacturers, especially in low and middle-income countries. The goal there is to help ensure safe and beneficial medicines, including antibiotics, so that substandard and falsified products are detected. Let me now walk you through the documentary standard setting process with USP, which I believe is similar to other pharmacopeias. We trust in partnerships and work with experts in health and science across industry, nonprofits, government, and academia to develop public standards, monographs, and reference standards that are critical in helping ensure quality medicines, dietary supplements, and food ingredients. USP monographs include the name of the ingredient or preparation, the definition, the packaging information, storage and labeling requirements, and of course, guidances. Within those monographs, you read specifications according to your test protocols that you are familiar with. Those specifications consist of series of tests, procedures for the tests, and acceptance criteria. These tests and procedures require the use of official USP reference standards. And a single monograph may include several different tests, procedures, and/or acceptance criteria that reflect the attributes, the quality attributes of different manufacturers, substances, and products approved in the United States market. For the monograph development process, we recognize two different processes. One is to keep already existing monographs up to date by a modernization product that help ensure the methods in the USP reflect those that industry currently uses. And we're constantly seeking for support with new monographs that become essential as a public standard as soon a patent of a drug product is extinct. We have a priority new monograph list on our website, and we encourage you to check these lists if you are a sponsor seeking to aid in developing monographs that are not currently part of the official USP-NF. USP-NF general chapters describe the detailed tests and procedures referred to in multiple monographs, so they are referenced there. In these descriptions of tests and procedures for application through individual monograph, You find descriptions and specifications of conditions in general chapters, as well as practices for pharmaceutical compounding. You find general information for the interpretation of compendial requirements, descriptions of general pharmaceutical storage, dispensing and packaging practices, or general guidances for manufacturers of official substances or official products. Each of these general chapters is assigned a number that appears in angle brackets. For example, the chromatography chapter that has the HPLC part in there, for example, is called 621. We often refer to 621 when we talk about HPLC topics, for example. Important to mention here is that 621 is a sub-1000 chapter, which is enforceable because it is referenced in either one or more of the monographs. General chapters numbered above 1000 are informational only. They are guidances, as mentioned before, interpretations of compendial requirements, descriptions of general pharmaceutical storage and dispensing. Essential to read at least once are the general notices. They are often forgotten to be the overall guiding principles for using the monographs and general chapters. They provide clarity for basic assumptions, definitions, and default conditions for the interpretation and application of the USP and DNF. We really encourage you to look up general notices, as I said, at least once, so you are aware where to find what in a situation you are reading a text in the USP-NF and you need further guidance, clarity, definitions, or whatsoever. As you can see from this flowchart, the development of monographs and reference standards is working in parallel. Let's stick with the monograph development for the sake of this presentation. Analytical methods and supporting documents are sponsored by the industry in most cases. They provide us with the analytical portion of the dossier, submit to the FDA for approval. We work with innovators and generic manufacturers and select those methods that are most up to date for the development of a monograph. The timing of the collaboration most often depends on the patent situation of each drug. 5 years prior to patent expiry, we reach out to the innovator and request their support. Depending their post-patent strategy of the particular drug they decide at which point within those 5 years they want to collaborate with us. In the meantime, generic manufacturers emerge with their submission for approval to FDA version of this drug. Their analytical methods often represent a more current industry standard with specifications and acceptance criteria as good as the innovator drug. At the end, we are responsible to select the best methods, regardless of the source. The analytical methods and supporting documents are evaluated by our scientific liaison, and if complete and scientific sound, they are formatted as specifications into the monograph style and shared as a first draft with the sponsor before publishing the proposal in the Pharmacopeia forum for public review. The Pharmacopeia forum will be in one of the next slides explained. It's basically a public free of charge platform for those people that are in a surveillance program to constantly review news and novelties that are proposed to the USP-NF. Within that public review, the comments that we receive during 90 days will be discussed with the expert committee. They approve the monograph for adoption into the USP-NF if no major concern was raised during the Pharmacopeia forum phase. Standards that are published in the USP-NF receive an implementation period of 6 months. Let's go into the USP-NF online tutorial. You can also start your journey to access the USP-NF online from the website dedicated for the USP-NF only. In here, you find all relevant information to the US Pharmacopeia. It also helps you navigate back to the USP.org website, featuring compendial tools that may help with your daily analytical requests. We won't go there, as a tutorial through the website could fill easily the content of another webinar like this. You also find FAQs on the USP-NF website, which really helps you in gathering the whole information around the USP-NF, its use and its establishment. So once you logged in to the USP-NF online with your access point credentials, you'll see this start layout. A good advice if you are not familiar with the website is to tap the Start Here button. For analytical advice, where to find what? If you are responsible, as mentioned, to frequently survey changes occurring in the pharmacopoeias and simply want to get a short glimpse of what has changed against the previous version, please also tap the Start Here button. On the top right, you see a label for Welcome Benoit. Benoit is one of our user personas. When you click on this area, you can manage your own account for the USP-NF online. So when you log in, obviously your name will appear up there. This page shows a search box at the top that's present and on every page, so you can always conduct a search no matter what page you are on. The USP-NF online dashboard is a learning platform where USP provide tips and tutorials to help users quickly get up to speed on the new system. And below that section, you see an icon that clearly indicates which version of the USP-NF you are viewing. And that is the official version. At the bottom are two tabs. One tab shows the most recent 20 page as user that the user has visited, making it easy to go back to any recently viewed page. The content of this tab is automatically generated by the system. The other tab shows the user's bookmarks. These are pages specifically saved by the user. The new search function provides autocomplete and auto-suggested functions. Results are sorted into categories such as monographs and general chapters and display on a drop-down list as you type. In here, using azithromycin as an example, 13 results will appear. On the monographs, you would have 5 results where azithromycin would appear in the general test and assays, and you have further 4 results related to front matter issues. Once you hit enter to complete the search, in this case azithromycin, the results are displayed on the page as shown. Each document clearly indicates its status and when it was published. A collection of filters on the left side allow you to narrow the search results according to a variety of criteria. These filters operate like the category filters on Amazon or other websites. the icon keys for currently official, not yet official, and no longer official are further explained in the help section under icon key. Let's hit the azithromycin monograph. The example of this monograph is displayed here. It is blue underlined just to show you where azithromycin as word is appearing everywhere in the whole text. And I wanted to point out that although the new design of the system looks very different from the old USP-NF, there have been no changes made to the content of the monographs or chapters, other than the regular update process that occurs each year. The changes you see here are in the way the information is displayed, but not in the information itself. Those of you who are completely new to the USP-NF might not know that the layout and the platform has changed 3 years ago. So this is what you see here. And again, no changes have been made to the content of the monographs and the chapters from the previous platform to the new layout, as we are giving you examples here. The green bar indicates that you are looking at the currently official version of that monograph. You can view newer or older versions by switching to the documents available on the document tools sections. Note that for each monograph, not only you can create a bookmark, but also an alert, so you can be notified of changes to that document. There are a couple of important informations that we need to mention. Information on referencing guidelines for document citations are part of the FAQ and can be rewrote there. With the new platform, USP is introducing a more document-centric model for the version control and presentation of our documentary standards. If you, those of you who remember the previous platform, they made citations to monographs based on the page where this monograph was displayed in the USP-NF. Not only have we no longer printed versions of the USP-NF available, moreover, this new document-centric model for the version control becomes essential for the reporting of your process. Important to mention is that whether a document is official or not official, it will no longer be linked to when a specific publication, such as the main USP-NF edition or one of the supplements, become official, but instead to status of the individual document. Each individual document within the new online publication has its own official date of reference, which is linked to a unique permanent documentary identifier, a unique doc ID, which is available in the new USP-NF online platform under auxiliary information at the complete bottom of a monograph. The unique doc ID will only change when there is a revision to the document. The unit doc ID do not change with each publication. This is the doc ID I was referring to. In the azithromycin monograph, on the complete button, when you scroll down of this monograph, you find under auxiliary information, several information, not only who is the scientific liaison responsible for this particular monograph and what expert committee is supporting, you find other supporting information, such as where to go when you need the column information that is not displayed in the monograph, as you may wish if you need to search for a column that is maybe not anymore available for analytical purpose. But you find at blue underlined at the very low bottom, what we already mentioned just previously, the current doc ID, which is unfortunately, a very long number, but be sure this number will not change except for the last digit, which in this case is a 5. And if the document has not changed to a more current version, the document ID for this particular monograph will remain to be the last issue of this doc ID number 5. It will subsequently change to 6, 7, 8, or 9 once the document is changing. For general references in your documents, test procedures, and dossiers, USP recommends using the name title of the monograph or general chapter. Such a general reference is understood to refer to the currently official version of that standard and may be appropriate in certain circumstances. E.g. SOPs, as I mentioned, policy documents, anything you need to have on a regular surveillance. Where it would be difficult or unnecessary to update the specific version of a standard to reflect each subsequent revision. For specific references, USP recommends using the unique doc ID that we just have shown you, which appears under auxiliary information. If you need more information on how to reference this doc ID best, you can visit, again, the USP-NF.com website. Under frequently asked questions, we'll refer to this topic again. This is what I promised you, and now moving away from the USP-NF online, I think as a tutorial itself, this could go far more beyond of the contents of just this webinar. So if you are interested to learn more about the USP-NF, you can always visit our website for other events related to just this topic. We also offer courses on the use of the USP-NF online, especially if you are new to the topic. But as promised before, the Pharmacopeia Forum that is featuring all the proposed documents that are drafted to form either a new monograph, general chapter, or are drafted to propose a revision of an already existing monograph or a general chapter to become up to date, is the platform that you can freely access. It's available since about 2 years under this new platform. There is also a legacy platform for previously proposed Pharmacopeia Forum issues. Every 2 months, we publish new proposals. Your collaboration is vital to the setting of quality standard, and I encourage you to frequently visit this page. Having been through the documentary standard setting process and a short USP-NF online tutorial, I would like to now go into some of the areas of the USP.org website that provides additional resources for your use. We have there an overview of USP education programs. It is fair to say that we're very proud of having already more than 50,000 students trained on various topics of the USP since 2000. We're covering many quality topics in our educational program, such as courses for drug products and API, biologics, general notices, and so forth. Those courses are created by the very scientists who developed the USP standards in collaboration with our scientific liaison, who is at the forefront of all knowledge and information regarding the general chapter. Our USP education department is creating the content, which is constantly updated to its current nature. We provide classroom education courses usually, but obviously given the times and the situation right now, we have moved over to a more virtual way of providing course content to our end users. We would also, in the normal situation, be able to provide laboratory practice sessions. What we do, like you know now, are live webcasts, webinars. But you also can order training programs that are self-paced, and you can learn on the way you go. Our USP website is providing you more information on who we are, what global impact we have, and what we work on. Our products and services, our events that we constantly offer, and how you could personally get involved in the standard setting process. We have created a reference standard app, especially for those who are maintaining internal stock of reference standards. It's a very, very easy tool that helps comply with USP reference standards. You receive notification through this app when a specific reference standard is updated. You can alert yourself for new reference standards when available. You can set bookmarks to reference standards particularly interested to you. And it also has a barcode scanning mechanism, which is easy to check on the valid use date for your reference standard on stock. USP offers a range of information, education videos, and compliance videos on the value beyond the vial, customer development management and development process, education, and scientific liaisons. We have educational videos as well on performance verification testing, the solution courses, how to effectively, for example, degas a media, essential for the PVT test. You can find videos on partnering with USP, contribute to our standards, and help develop reference standard material. Our four main email addresses, starting with customer service, obviously, where you can order reference standard or send in your queries. Reference standard technical support is managed by Lisa Corbin. She wants you to send in your requests to a generic version of her email address, which is rstech@usp.org, simply for the reason for her to manage all incoming queries, eventual complaints, notifications in one system, so she can manage this on their part more effectively. The same applies for USP API and drug product monographs, of which requests should be sent in to stdsmonographs@usp.org. Brian Gilbert is the persona behind this support, whereas Robert Lafaware is supporting national formulary, part, excipient monographs, dietary supplements, and general chapters under nfmonographs@usp.org. And by the way, I've been always referring to USP and USP-NF. You saw a little bit of history in the beginning. You saw that USP and NF were actually two different pharmacopoeias independent from each other. We merged in the 70s to one pharmacopoeia and called ourselves the USP-NF. Ever since, the USP part of the USP-NF have become the API and drug product monograph sections together with general chapters and the general notices, whereas NF, the national formulary part, featuring excipient monographs, dietary supplements, and of course, general chapters as well. So with this, I'm thanking you for your attention. I hope it was informational to you. And I would suggest that we do now a quick poll of three questions just for us to understand how much of the delivered content of this webinar was understood and where we eventually could do some improvements.
Thank you very much, Alex. Yes, indeed, it was a very clear and a very comprehensive presentation. Thank you so much. You did a great job.
You're welcome. Thank you.
As Alex mentioned, we are now proceeding to the poll. You have now on your screen three different questions. I will read them. And again, I repeat myself, those and your answers will remain anonymous. So feel free to answer, even if you are not 100% sure. The first question is, USP has access to NDA and ANDA filings to help establish the monograph. Is it false or is it true? USP has access to NDA and ANDA filings to help establish the monograph. The second question is, only the innovator can sponsor a monograph of an ingredient or finished dosage form. Is it false or is it true? Third question is, USP-NF Online is the only official format. Please answer to those questions. USP has access to NDA and ANDA filings to help establish the monographs. Only the innovator can sponsor a monograph of an ingredient or finished dosage form. USP-NF Online is the only official format. Don't forget to click on submit once you have answered those questions. Christian, where are we now?
Yeah, we have 52% of the participants submitted the poll, finished the poll. There are 10 more percent in progress, and I think we can probably close it now to show the results. It's running already for 2 minutes. Okay. Please also put your questions, if you have one or two, in the question and answers field so that we can respond to that right now here. So I'm closing now the poll. And we should have it now. So we have poll results shown here, Benoit.
Okay, so I repeat the first question. USP has access to NDA and ANDA filings to help establish the monograph. Well, if I read the results, I see kind of, half answering false and true. Well, actually, this is false. USP develops standards based on data that are submitted by market authorization holders who received NDA or ANDA from FDA. Those data are private. They belong to the market authorization holders. FDA has not the right to disclose confidential information, proprietary information to USP. So the only source for USP is actually the market authorization holder itself. So there. Answer to this question is actually false. The second question, only the innovator can sponsor a monograph of an ingredient or finished dosage form. This is false. The correct answer is false, which represents majority of the answers we received. That's right. A monograph can be sponsored by a generic manufacturer as well, as long as an NDA was granted. So the source of the monograph is coming either from innovator or from a generic manufacturer, again, as long as the market authorization, NDA or ANDA, was granted. The third question, USP-NF Online is the only official format. Here, the correct answer is actually true. But let me explain you a little bit further. It is true as of 2020, print and USB formats will be discontinued. Only the changes and revision of the previous year will be published as a book. So if you want to have the whole content of official documents, only one source is available. This is the USP-NF online, and this since 2020, this year. Thank you very much for your answers. And I think it is now time to move to the question and answer session. So please ask your question, use the chat system so that we can get your questions. Christian, I don't see the questions.
Okay, you don't see it, right? No. I can ask some questions. So the first question that came up is, do we record the webinar and do we make it available later, or can we share the slides? Alex Benoit, do you want to answer? Shall I answer?
I can. We're not allowed to share the slides, but we are recording these webinars, and we will put those recordings at a website at some point, which we probably will disclose soon after this webinar. The platform is not yet 100% sure. It could be YouTube or it could be Facebook, depending on the opportunities that we have. But those who have already participated and also registered to the webinar will be notified on the location of these recorded webinars.
Okay, thank you. Alex, there's another question. Please, can you tell us about which parts and sections of the monograph of a drug substance, drug product monograph is legally binding for a drug product manufacturer?
Well, legally binding is, first of all, only for those who are marketing their products in the United States, have approved drug products in the United States. So the parts of the monographs are legally binding in the sense that they are enforceable. It is a compliance standard that we publish, meaning that you can ensure yourself that if and when you test your product for the quality attributes written in the USP-NF, you will pass. In all fairness to say, nobody really is taking the risk if marketing to the United States, so they test each and every batch that is released to the US market under the quality attributes as outlined in the USP-NF. So the monograph specifications are legally binding. Within the monographs, as mentioned, general chapters are appearing as general test procedures to fulfill the analytical test procedures accordingly. If mentioned in a monograph, a general chapter is legally binding as well.
Okay, thank you very much.
I see another question. Can you visit us right now, or can we meet virtually maybe? Well, I can take this one, of course. Visiting you is definitely something we would like to do, of course. But as you know, travel restrictions apply, and it would be very difficult for us to travel. It is very difficult for us to travel nowadays. This is what we do usually, but not anymore right now. Can we meet virtually maybe? Yes, of course. So if you want to have a discussion with us, a virtual discussion on the web, you may reach out to us, and we can organize definitely a virtual meeting to assist you further.
I can only second that comment, Benno. We would really love to engage with you over the means we have right now, being it a WebEx telephone, email. Just reach out to us.
Another question is, what are the page information on top of unique document ID? If you read the, indeed, if you remember the slide from Alex, yes. Alex, on above the document ID itself, you have the page information. As we said, as Alex said in the past, we were referring the page number of a specific document. And for instance, USP-41NF36, the azithromycin monograph was on page 420. We no longer do that because we are moving away from the format, the print format version. But this is related to the old print that we were releasing in the past.
Yeah, we have another question here on the in the question and answers box. If you want to obtain a chapter, like for example, general chapter 661 from USP, do you need to buy the full NF subscription, or can it be also obtained as a standalone document?
It is possible.
Go ahead.
No, please.
We are working on a more modular platform of the USP-NF, where only single areas of the USP-NF can be accessed to if you don't need the whole content of the USP-NF, but that's future. Right now, you can ask a single document for purchase, which will then be a PDF created and available for you to download. It would have to go either through us first or directly to customer service to mention the specific document that you would like to order. And then they'll give you a price. I'm not any more sure, because I did not follow in the past such requests, but I think a document to process through customer service, a PDF that has been sent to you, is in the area between 100 and 150 euros. So if you consider the whole document to cost $700 for a single access license, I mean, you do the math, how economically this is, depending on how many more single documents you would want to obtain over the time.
And I would add to what Alex said, that if you get a single document like a general chapter, it is, you get the document, but it is out of the environment itself. So you miss all the other information, such as general chapters, the monograph, and so on. So, I mean, it's your call, of course, but this is not something I would recommend, especially as the difference between the price of the single document and the price of the whole USP-NF. The difference is not that big. So, I mean, it's your decision, of course. Another question that I received, which is quite an interesting one. What if a monograph states a reference standard that is not available? First of all, a reference standard may not be available because it has never been released by USP. So there is no entry of this specific reference standard in the USP catalog. That is very rare, but if that is the case, the procedure calling out for this specific reference standard is not official until the reference standard is made available in the USP catalog. Now, if it is a reference standard that exists in the catalog, but is currently not available, it's on back order, then the situation is different. The procedure remains official. Any other question?
Yes, we have one more question.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, we have one more questions here. One more question here. If there are concerns with any of the USP monographs methods, the analytical methods there, then what is the procedure? How we can get in contact with USP? What is the procedure there?
So depending it is a NF or a USP monograph or even a general chapter, you probably remember those email addresses I've given you. They are the first line of technical support, meaning that they can address your concern with suggestions on how to improve the situation, the analytical situation in using this monograph or general chapter in your laboratory. If you end up, you know, confirming together with our technical support that in fact there is an issue with the analytical procedure, then you could initiate a revision with the USP-NF, which would ask you to submit the scientific basis for your concern, which is a procedure that is described as well on our website. If you need further information, again, please reach out to us individually.
Yeah, and maybe also good to know for the users that a scientific liaison is always mentioned at the end of the documentary standard. In the online version, well, also in the print, but it can be contacted, the person can be contacted very easily. Also from the online version, there's directly the contact mention at each end of the documentary standard, monographs or general chapters. Yeah, I think.
I received a question, a private question actually. Which is more common than a question or a suggestion, let's say. Can we have a catalog details of impurities separately as some customers are requesting for it? Right now, our catalog encompass everything, the impurities together with APIs and excipients and so on. I take it as a suggestion, but for now, there is no separate catalog.
We have also some questions here that are all referring to harmonization. Maybe we can give a quick update on harmonization here as well, or how we harmonize monographs and general chapters to a certain extent.
Okay, I can take this one. There are two types of harmonization: the retrospective harmonization and the prospective harmonization. The retrospective harmonization is about harmonizing documents that exist already. In the late 80s, I think it was in 1989, the three main pharmacopoeias at that time, the JP, the EP, and the USP, they created a group called the Pharmacopoeial Discussion Group, the PDG. The goal of the PDG is to harmonize existing monographs, or retrospective harmonization, and they decided to harmonize, let's say, broad impact documents. So there, in the scope of the PDG, they selected roughly, if I remember well, close to 70 excipient monographs, which are broadly used, so the best sellers, as well as a certain number of general chapters, because if you want to harmonize an excipient monograph, you need also to harmonize the corresponding procedures. On top of that, ICH told the PDG to harmonize additional general chapters like microbiology or dissolution. So the PDG is working on harmonization of those excipients and general chapters. The process is fairly long, fairly slow. It's a steady process though, but right now I think we have more or less harmonized the majority of the general chapters, and we have still another, I think, 10 or 15 monographs for excipients to harmonize. I remember in the past, Alex and I, Alex, we remember as well, we used to have a very good colleague, Terry Way, who was always mentioning a joke about that. And the joke is the following. You have three people sitting around the table talking about harmonization of the monograph, and each of them saying, harmonization, it's very easy, so long you do it my way. So that means that harmonization is a difficult exercise. There are a lot of hurdles, a lot of barriers, and it's not just about regulatory environment, legal environment, but it's also about scientific judgment and expertise. So this is what we do on harmonization, on retrospective harmonization with through the PDG. And again, it is a part of the resolution of the USP to work on harmonization. The second process for harmonization is called the prospective harmonization. This is a different process because here there is no existing monograph in either, for instance, EP and USP. And a sponsor market authorization holder might want to submit the data to both EP and USP as long as we end up with a monograph that will be harmonized at the end. So it's called prospective harmonization. This is not a formal process like the PDG process. This is a more an informal process. We are working on, this time we work on API harmonization, API prospective harmonization, and we were fairly successful. I don't know exactly how many monographs we harmonized this way, but I think we are close to 50 monographs. We do the same as well with the British Pharmacopeia, who is developing standards for finished dosage forms. So we work with EP from API and with BP for dosage forms. I don't think that the JP is part of this process. I don't think, I have not heard about that, but I don't think they are part of that.
Yeah, I can confirm they are not. Yeah.
Yeah. How about harmonization with Chinese pharmacopeia? Any plan for this? Well, I don't know all the details, but there is no specific, there is no real collaboration with the Chinese pharmacopeia and the USP on specific harmonization. What I can say is that every year there is a kind of congress or a symposium, I don't know exactly, that gather all the pharmacopeia of the world. And I think there are around 30 different pharmacopeias. And they discuss about the process to develop and establish standards. And the purpose, I think, is to set up what they call good pharmacopeial practices. Good pharmacopeial practices aim to have a more harmonized process to develop standards. I'm not 200% sure about that. If Alex and Christian, do you have any additional comments on this topic?
Not on my side, no.
Me neither, no.
Okay.
Yeah. So we have a few more questions. Yeah, there are a few more other questions, but I would say we should discuss those offline and send to the users directly. They are very special questions that are right now somewhat difficult to reply to. Yeah.
Wasn't there one on pending monographs? Maybe that one quickly we can take.
Yeah, go ahead. Where do you see that? Yeah, please. Please do.
That was a question quickly appearing somewhere. Maybe it was even in my personal private chat, but I don't have that open. So everyone who wanted to discuss with me privately, I'm sorry, I haven't seen that. It was just a question shortly appearing, and I think it was related to what's the meaning of pending monograph. And I think this was seen when we had the slide of the USP-NF. Website where there was a specific section of pending monographs. Pending monographs are monographs that we have developed together with a sponsor of analytical methods and supporting documents, a sponsor who has not yet received approval to market its drug product in the United States. They are still in process, meaning pending, to receive FDA's approval. Our guidance and policies allow the collaboration with an industry partner, a so-called sponsor, as soon as they have sent in their application to the FDA. And whatever present as analytical method at that time will be used to develop the monograph. The monograph will separately be approved by our expert committee and sits there as an already by expert committee approved monograph until the drug product is approved by the FDA. The risk always could be that FDA is requesting more data or to change certain data that are part of the data package submitted to USP. So the risk could be that some changes would need to be made once the approval of the FDA has been given to the drug product. If there are no changes to the document package, these pending monographs, yet approved already by the expert committee, don't have to go through a public process again, meaning through the Pharmacopeia forum. As soon as the drug product is approved by the FDA, these pending monographs are being published to the USP-NF and begin to be official, again with a 6-month implementation period. I hope that answers the question.
I don't see any other question. Do you?
Yeah, as I said, there are a few, but they are very special, and we should.
Yeah, we can take them offline. That's fine.
Offline, yeah, yeah.
So thank you, everybody. Thanks for attending this meeting. It was really great having an opportunity to speak to you via this way. I think Benoit is taking it from here.
Yes. Thank you for the great session and the great presentation, Alex. It was a wonderful job. And we received quite a few questions, and we could engage with our customers. But of course, as we said already, we can engage with customers even further through private discussions and webinars. We can meet virtually. So Alex, Christian, myself, we do remain at your disposal should you have anything to discuss with us further. So with this, I think it's time to conclude this presentation. Thank you very much, everyone, for your attendance. I hope you enjoyed. I hope you got valuable information. And again, thank you, Alex, for your presentation.
You're absolutely welcome. Thank you very much for moderating and keeping everything in shape. By the way, Christian Seiner, who is in the background, I'm not sure. I was not following correctly your introduction, Benoit. I'm not sure whether he was introduced. Christian Seiner is our head scientific affairs at USP office in Basel, and he is supporting us and industry on scientific and technical matters. Thanks also, Christian, to support this session. And by the way, the next webinar will be held by Christian himself. So there you get a fair opportunity to be introduced to him a little more personally. So thanks, everyone, and goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.